This is Legends of the Diamond, a show where I talk about some of the greatest professional baseball players ever to play the game that you might not know about because of a terrible era of segregation and racism in the United States and Major League Baseball. And while Major League Baseball is now finally beginning to recognize the Negro Leagues and the pre-Negro League era as Major Leagues, there is still so much to learn about these amazing ball players, especially since many of the feats either weren't documented or could only be pieced together from newspaper clippings, many with horrible racist undertones from so-called sports writers who failed to understand the greatness that they were witnessing. 14 no-hitters, a perfect game, 5,081 strikeouts, 86 shutouts, a 1.37 ERA, yes, John Wesley Donaldson is one of the greatest pitchers of all time. Let's take a deeper dive and look at this real life legend.
He was the poetry and rhythm of baseball. That quote from the now defunct newspaper, the Lake Wilson Pilot from Minnesota, is a good way to describe one of the greatest pitchers of all time that you might not have ever heard of. John Wesley Donaldson, born in Glasgow, Missouri on February 20, 1891. And it wasn't easy for African Americans at that time. The area was known for murderous lynch mobs during the late 1800s, early 1900s, and his father James and mother Ida Hurt were a part of the first generations that were born free following the Civil War. Baseball became a love for Donaldson, as he helped Evans Grade School win an 8-cities championship. He also attended Evans High School and graduated with high honors. He attended George R. Smith College in Sedalia, Missouri for a year after high school, but it was baseball that Donaldson wanted in his life. At 17 years old, he began a career that spanned 32 years, from 1908 to 1941, with another game documented in 1949. And even though Donaldson clearly had the skills for Major League Baseball, he was black during a time of segregation. Instead of letting that obstacle stop him from playing, he made a career out of playing for black and mixed-race barnstorming teams, or teams that traveled around and had exhibition matches outside of organized athletic leagues. He also later made rosters of various small-town Minnesota teams, despite most of the players being white. And his early career is said to be a model that Satchel Paige later used to make a living as a baseball player. Donaldson's career began with the Missouri Hanukkah Blues and the Missouri Tigers between 1908 and 1910. In documented wins based on newspaper clippings, he was dominant on the mound. In a game on September 13, 1908, he struck out 17 batters, and he struck out 15 batters in multiple games in 1909 and 1910. He later played for the Browns Tennessee Minstrels, also called the Rats, in 1911, where he is documented in playing over 60 games that summer in Iowa, Minnesota, Missouri, South Dakota, and Nebraska. In one documented game on April 15, 1911, Donaldson and the Minstrels traveled to Novinger, Missouri, to take on the all-white Kirksville Leaguers. He only allowed one hit and struck out the first 11 batters, finishing with 19 strikeouts and a complete game win. He struck out 27 batters in a win in Coon Rapids, Iowa, and had 31 strikeouts in a game in Humboldt, Iowa later that year. Donaldson's record on the mound that season is reported as 44-3 overall, helping the Minstrels to a reported 184-17 record. It wasn't long before people who saw him play recognized him as one of the best pitchers in the game. He later played on the All Nations team until 1918 and also played for the Royal Poinciana Hotel in Palm Beach, Florida, the Los Angeles White Sox, the Brooklyn Royal Giants, and the Indianapolis ABCs during that stretch. It is documented that he had 100 consecutive shutout innings from 1913 to 1914 and had 30 consecutive innings of no-hit baseball in 1915. Half of his documented no-hitters came between 1912 and 1917. Imagine if he had a chance to show off his skills in the MLB at a time when the Chicago Cubs and Chicago White Sox were dominating the league. It is said that New York Giants manager John McGraw offered Donaldson $10,000 to change his name, move to Cuba, and come to the majors by exploiting a loophole in segregation, but the stipulation also meant him renouncing his family and not to associate with any black people ever again. Donaldson was not about to abandon his mother or his roots. He is quoted as saying, "I am not ashamed of my color," which is noted in the John Donaldson Network research website. And so he continued on. In 1919, he played for the Detroit Stars and the Chicago American Giants, which was a team organized by Rube Foster. Of course, Foster is the man who helped start the Negro Leagues the following year. Donaldson also remained with the All Nations team in 1920. 1920 was also the time when he began a career with the Kansas City Monarchs, the longest-running franchise in the history of the Negro National League. Donaldson actually helped create the team and is rumored to be credited with coming up with the name. He pitched, played center field, and batted cleanup for the Monarchs. He actually has a documented average of .320 in 1920 to go along with his pitching, though he didn't actually pitch much for the Monarchs, with some attributing arm fatigue to his absence on the mound. Later, he played for towns in Minnesota, including Bertha, Lismore, Madison, and Minneota. He also played for the Minnesota towns Browerville, Browns Valley, Melrose, Arlington, Chisholm, Clarkfield, and St. Cloud. The move to small towns in Minnesota was because he was now in his 30s, and he was getting away from the grueling schedule of barnstorming teams where he might play 7 games a week, all of them in different cities. It was in Fergus Falls, Minnesota in 1925 that W.T. Oxley took amateur video footage of Donaldson pitching in an exhibition game. Oxley was given a Kodak 16mm video camera, which was a fairly new model at the time. Oxley gives us a glimpse into the delivery of Donaldson, and it shows a power style that didn't really exist at the time. Per Buck O'Neill, a first baseman for the Kansas City Monarchs, Donaldson had a changeup, a curveball, and a fastball. And he also threw a slider well before anyone else, some saying 20 years before anyone else. Donaldson played for a team called John Donaldson's All-Stars from 1931 to 1934, and for the Joe Green's Chicago Giants from 1934 to 1937, and again in 1940. In 1939, he had a stint with Satchel Paige's All-Stars as well, and he also played a game as a 58-year-old in 1949. Donaldson was one of the highest-paid players of his peers, earning $450 a month at his peak. The income and reputation allowed him to choose where he wanted to play year after year with so many interesting destinations. But as his career wound down due to age, Donaldson was not done with baseball. He might not have crossed into the major leagues as a pitcher, but he inspired others and made other history. In 1949, Donaldson was hired by the Chicago White Sox as the first full-time African-American scout in Major League Baseball history. He scouted players like Willie Mays and Ernie Banks and recommended the White Sox sign them. But the White Sox management didn't take his advice and passed on both players. I am sure there are current White Sox fans who would realize the blunder of management at the time. Imagine a team with Willie Mays and Ernie Banks to go along with the Go-Go Sox of 1959. Per Buck O'Neill, Donaldson told the Sox that if they don't want good players, he didn't want the job, after being upset with the team passing on the future Hall of Famers. But he remained and still made some contributions. Donaldson did get Bob Boyd signed as the first African-American player on the White Sox. Boyd batted .297 with 3 home runs, 23 RBIs, and 20 runs scored, and 165 at-bats for the White Sox in 1953. Connie Johnson was a pitcher Donaldson brought to the White Sox. Johnson was 11-9 in 28 starts with 7 complete games and 3 shutouts in 3 seasons in 1953, 1955, and 1956. He had 122 strikeouts and 172 innings. Donaldson also stocked the minor league team in Colorado Springs with talent before he retired. Donaldson remained in Chicago with his wife Eleanor, working for the U.S. Post Office after baseball. He passed away on April 14, 1970 from bronchial pneumonia at the age of 79. While not in the National Baseball Hall of Fame yet for some reason, Donaldson is immortalized in his hometown of Glasgow, Missouri. On September 4th, 2020, a statue and field were dedicated in his honor. Perhaps the National Baseball Hall of Fame will come to his senses and honor this amazing baseball player in the future, because in my eyes, he is a surefire Hall of Famer. I am Anthony Iozzo, and this is Legends of the Diamond. Thank you for liking and subscribing. Join me next week for another look at an amazing ballplayer you might not know much about. If there is anyone you would like me to research for this show, please leave the name in the comments.